We have a semi-batch reactor with heat exchange, and we have two reactions taking place. One's exothermic and one's endothermic. We're given the rates of reaction, and then we tell how much of reactant A is in the reactor initially, and then we're going to continue to feed A into the reactor. And so the volume, of course, increases with time. We're given the heat transfer. This is the heat transfer coefficient times the area. We have a constant cooling temperature just to make the calculations a little more straightforward. We're assuming this is a cooling coil, so as we increase the volume, we're not increasing the heat transfer area. And then we're simplifying by assuming the density is the same for all the components, and the heat capacity, the mass heat capacity, is the same. What we want to do is calculate the concentrations of products as a function of time. So essentially, we're going to have to solve mass balances and energy balances simultaneously, and we're going to do that numerically. In the example, in this case, we'll use polymath as a program to solve these and show the output from polymath. The first thing, let's make a drawing to represent the system behavior. So this represents a reactor system, and what we're going to do first is write down mass balances, which are differential equations. This is an unsteady state system. We have the change. N sub A is the total number of moles of reactor at any given time. What's going to change for two reasons? One, we're adding A. This is the molar flow rate entering reactor, and then reacting away A. And so we are given R1, that's generic, so we need the stoichiometric coefficient times R1, stoichiometric coefficient, first reaction, minus 1 for A, times R1, times the volume, and keep in mind the volume is changing with time. Now we need initial conditions to solve this, and that's that NA is initially equal to NA0, which is 300 moles. We're going to do the same thing for B. We don't have any B flowing into the reactor or flowing out, so the only terms are because of reaction. So we make B in the first reaction, so stoichiometric coefficient plus 1. We react it, and there's 2 moles of B reacting, so it's 2 times R2 times volume. An initial condition in B is equal to 0. And then the other component, since we want the concentrations, it's the number of moles of D respect to time. There's no D flowing in or out, so the only D is because of reaction, so stoichiometric coefficient plus 1, and we start with no D in the reactor. So these are initial conditions. Mass balances, now we just need to write down the energy balance. So now let's look at energy balance for this system. So let's scroll up. Because the heat capacities are constant and we have mass heat capacities, we take the density times the volume. Keep in mind the volume is changing with time. Density times the volume is going to be the mass in the reactor times the mass heat capacity, which is a constant, derivative temperature respect to time. This is how the energy in the reactor is changing with time. Well, this is happening because we have flow rate in. So density and a volumetric flow rate, that's the mass flow rate. Again, the mass heat capacity. And then T0 minus T. This is the feed temperature. And this is the reactor temperature. And then we have two terms due to two reactions. Let me write them down. Heat reaction for the first reaction, the rate of reaction times the volume. And so the question that comes up is, why is this a negative sign? And the explanation is that we can understand what's happening in a reactor. If we have an exothermic reaction, then we expect, if we're adiabatic, we expect this term to be positive. So if this were negative, and the negative sign, and R1 is positive, then we're showing the right behavior. So sometimes it's best just to think through what would happen for different types of reactions. If it's endothermic, of course, we expect the temperature to decrease in the adiabatic reactor. And the second reaction is endothermic. And then the last term is the heat transfer coefficient times the heat transfer area. Let's call it a cooling temperature. Could be heating temperature, depends on the conditions. So this is our value of 320 Kelvin. This, of course, is the same reactor temperature. And so we need one more equation, and that's the equation for the change in the volume with respect to time. Well, it's a pretty simple equation that we could solve. We have the initial conditions for both of these equations, these differential equations. The initial condition for the energy is that T is equal to 350 Kelvin initially. And the initial condition for the volume is that the volume is equal to 50 liters. So now we have five differential equations. Make them all visible. Five differential equations, five initial conditions. We're going to start at T equals zero, integrate for long enough time. Now the problem asks us to calculate concentration. So let's write down the equations so we can calculate these concentrations. Concentration of A, number of moles of A, which of course is changing with time, divided by the volume, which is also changing with time. And then of course, the same thing for B and D. So we're going to put these five differential equations with their initial conditions, then the three equations for concentrations. Then we're going to put the constants that were given in the problem statement, the rate of reaction in terms of temperature were given in the problem statement, and then we can solve all these simultaneously in polymath. So let's look at the polymath solution. So here's the output from polymath. The concentration of A decreases with time, as we expect. Concentration of B is going through a maximum in this series reaction, and then the concentration of D increases continuously. And we've run this long enough that the concentration of A gets pretty low. The temperature plot for these conditions, notice there's a slight increase in temperature and then basically the cooling temperature and the endothermic reaction causes the temperature to decrease. The polymath program that we use to generate this is listed here. And now, how to use polymath is explained in detail in other screencasts, so I'm just going to briefly point out a few aspects of the program. Here are the differential equations and their initial conditions. It doesn't matter which order we write them in polymath. These are three equations for the concentration and their relationship to volume and number of moles. And then our starting time and our final time, they have to be put in this format in polymath. The rate expressions that were given in the problem statement, and then all the parameters. And so polymath then generates the plots that show how concentrations change. So it's very easy to solve differential equations than using something like polymath.